alaikum and welcome to Making a House a Home with myself, Sana Araji, and our guest Fahima Muhammad, a qualified life coach and an NLP practitioner. Assalamu alaikum, Fahima. Now, today one of the topics we're going to be discussing is encouraging continuous learning and personal development.
Yes.
Can you emphasize a bit about this subject for us?
Yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even states in the Holy Book that those of you who believe will have the highest ranks of seeking and attaining knowledge. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we have to obviously bring it back to what is, you know, required upon us as we, you know, are believers. And also that, you know, it's an obligation, you know, for every Muslim to be acquiring and seeking knowledge continuously throughout their life. Mm. And also that, you know, knowledge should be sought and taken upon from cradle to grave.
Yeah.
So our Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, and the family, you know, has very, you know, distinctly made these sort of statements so that we can actually build upon ourselves as individuals, no matter where we are in life, no matter what age or stage or anything. And, you know, it's really normal that we say this a lot and we hear this, and we have a lot of professionals, especially in our communities, that, you know, with the highest sort of like, you know, degrees and levels and continuous learning. But I want to address something which is slightly different, which is having knowledge and having wisdom and having personal development is slightly different.
Okay.
Knowledge, you know, we have information, and now it's so widely available. We can even go and sometimes diagnose ourselves as, you know, when we, before we go to the GP, we can Google, we get all the information, you know, available to us, very simple and easy, and that's knowledge. So we need to take a step further with this statements that the Quran has given us to say that when people are just only satisfied with that sort of knowledge, it is not enough. We need to continue and we need to look deeper and we need to give it more meaning.
Right.
And when that becomes knowledge about like the academics and the world, environment and whatever that may be, that's good learning.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, it's good awareness. But personal development, now that's a whole new level of learning.
Mm.
It's what I work with most definitely, with people to, you know, improve themselves and develop themselves, and even the ones that are the most professional, the ones that are such in high levels and positions in their, you know, in their companies or in their businesses, they find it hard to cope with the mundane things or the things that you and I would find, you know, quite normal in, you know, everyday life. And again, it's to do with the psychology. And a lot of personal developers, they're called gurus, personal development gurus. They suggest even that even if you have a talent or a skill,
right,
in order for it to actually be to its potential, 80% of you being successful is the psychology. And the 20% is the skill and the talent. So the personal development is so, so vital for us as individuals to take it upon ourselves to learn and develop how and way we think, we behave. And NLP, neuro-linguistic programming, is what I'm, you know, certified in as well. You know, it helps people understand the way in which they communicate internally and externally,
right,
to ourselves and to others. And it's so important and vital in our businesses, in our interactions at home, at work, colleagues, wherever we are. And personal development, a lot of adults do it, but I try to even have children even think about it too. Because from a young age, you need to be able to be resilient.
Yes,
you need to be able to be versatile. Mm. You need to be able to overcome challenges. This is all personal development learning. So you might have knowledge of mindfulness, for example, or positive psychology, which again I'm also certified in with regards to coaching. How do we use this in a practical basis to actually put it in our lives?
That's a lot of people
know it.
Sometimes.
A lot of people know it. They can give you the theory, they can tell you what it means, they can tell you this is how it works, but they don't practice it.
Mm-hmm.
Now I work with clients to help them make it part of their daily routine in life.
Okay.
And I help them hold them accountable. Especially if they're going to continue with me.
Mm.
Not in a bad way, because they see the transformation, they see the differences, and it's unbelievably amazing. And it does have a huge impact in their lives, personally and professionally. It has a huge impact in the way in which they look at life, regardless of, you know, what they're facing.
Right.
And the client's feedback is like, you know, my situation's probably gone worse, but you know what? I'm handling it. Now that's the difference. That's the power of having knowledge, continuous learning, and especially personal development. Mm. Your psychology of your surroundings, of your awareness of how to deal with life, how to understand life. You know, Islam gives us the meaning and our purpose of being here. When I did existential coaching as well, it's about trying to understand and, you know, build yourself as a human where you understand our purpose for being okay. here. Mm-hmm. And for us, we know that from a religious perspective, but we also have to understand that, yes, there's givens where we know there's life and death. We know there's certain things we can see. There's certain things we see, but we know we don't know of. We also know that we don't know things completely. It's blind spots. So we want to create awareness that we can bring ourselves to the point where we can deal with stuff that we don't see at all.
Right.
Or if it comes to us, we're able to deal with it.
Okay.
Life is complicated, mm. and at the same time, it can be simple, depending how you look at it.
So with, when you, like for example, when someone comes to you and you coach them, it can help them react differently to a challenge that before would have maybe been, you know, a huge thing to them, and
yes.
it would have affected their emotional status, their life, their, you know, their working life, their social groups, whereas they would now be more resilient with certain
Absolutely.
Things. And I think resilience is a really key thing for children as well,
yes.
because a lot of the time what they find difficult is to overcome
yeah.
challenges.
Or pick themselves up.
To pick themselves up and to find ways to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
So in that aspect, what you're saying is quite beneficial to kind of coach them towards, you know, achieving that.
Yes, and Islam always says, what is your meaning and purpose in life mm-hmm. is here. It's life is a test.
Of course, yes, subhanAllah.
We keep saying it, but then we keep complaining when we keep getting these tests and we don't know what to do and we get anxious, stressful, and we get depressed. Not to say that these things don't overwhelm us, that we cannot get to the stages. No, absolutely, we do get to it because mm-hmm. we're humans and we have our weaknesses and shortcomings. But I'm there to tell you there are steps and stages and ways in which you can overcome this or you can prevent yourself from doing this
yeah.
or getting to that stage of depression, which is really, really vital. A lot of people seek counseling as well and they divulge in their past. But with coaches, we look at the present and we move forward. So that's the difference. It's not really like counseling. We don't feel that our clients needs fixing or they're broken. They just come to a crossroads and they just need to know which direction to take, or they're a little bit overwhelmed with certain things and they need to be able to cope better or perform at the higher level than they are doing already. So it's really a healthy way of, you know, living life to seek this. It's not a therapist, but a life coach is there to, you know, encourage you and to open up your view a lot wider.
Okay.
And so, to see yeah. things differently and to also interrupt that internal dialogue that's continuously in your mind mm-hmm. that's telling you these stories that stops you, that makes you doubtful, makes you suspicious, makes you feel whatever negative things, because that's the normal human mind, is that feeling of negativity, which is vital for our survival. But if you don't understand it well enough, it can hold you back, especially with fear.
And it controls you.
And it controls you. Mm. And again, with fear, I have given lots of talks on overcoming fear and being more confident and positive, and that comes into it. So I think when we look at education, we need to change our view a little bit because it's so much more widespread. And it's not just gaining information. It's what information is going to do for us practically.
Okay.
How are we going to use it in our daily lives? It's just like with prayer. Mm. We know how to pray. We know the benefits of prayer. And we do it in robotic form
right.
without gaining the real benefits because it's so continuous in a sense that it's kind of done blindly.
Mm.
But when you sit and reflect, and mindfulness can help with that, and, you know, and knowing that if you give it a set amount of focus, then those benefits will actually come into play. So it's really important that we find ourselves, especially when we are already accomplished and adults, to not stop.
Mm.
Because it's very easy for us to say we've done our degree, our master's, we've done what we needed to do, and you know, and we're not connecting with our children, and this life is difficult. It's not difficult, it's just you're not understanding it because you're not in it.
You're not willing to learn anything
yeah.
new because you think what you know is enough.
Yeah, that is one group of you know, adults. Then the other group of adults is they will take it upon themselves to be continuously learning, but then also the direction they go in is like further courses of study, which is about, which is not a bad thing, but again, it's more like academic level where, you know, learning a different subject, learning a different skill, which is fine, but they do not work on their mind.
Yeah.
They do not work on how to cope with things. They do not work on how to see things. They do not work on understanding human behavior, human nature. And I think everyone has a responsibility to do that. Even every school should be. I gave a talk to a local school about introducing coaching in education because it's vital for teachers and for the children. It really is vital for any type of human in whichever profession you're in to add it alongside what you're doing. It brings a different sense of a being when you are becoming more of a coach. You know, you have a different way of thinking, of understanding, of, you know, questioning and listening deeply. And you actually, within that person's, you know, environment, sitting with them, totally for them, on the same level. And that is so special. And that is so... you know, those sessions that I have, it just from that hour or whatever they choose to do, that few minutes that they have, you know, I'm a catalyst for what happens afterwards or in between. You know, when you have a different sense of information and you actually use it, you don't realize how you are growing and learning. When people say they don't have time to read books, I download my books on iPhone. iBooks on my phone, and I will even spend maybe 2 minutes or 5 minutes waiting for somebody, and I will just open one page and read something, and one information, one line from that book is something I will remember forever than saying I've read, you know, a whole like book in a week and do that.
And even people who find, if they do find books too difficult, articles.
There's so many ways.
So many ways. We're constantly bombarded with information wherever we go. Billboards, leaflets, brochures, articles online.
Mm-hmm.
So that we always have opportunities to absorb information.
Yes.
Obviously, we do need to be careful that it's genuine and it's, you know, that this it isn't fake news,
yeah,
and where the resources are from. But we have, like you said, there are so many ways that we are able to learn, develop, read. And do you feel sometimes with professions, like you had mentioned before, they're a bit complacent because they think, because they do know, they're at a certain level where they've studied, they've got a bachelor, maybe a master's, a PhD. And a lot of the time I've heard stories with certain individuals where suicidal rates are high.
Yeah.
Is that where that's coming from?
That's interesting, actually, because it's just like with anything in life. You chase something, and if there's no meaning and purpose into it, because you've got a sight to say, this degree or this master's or this bachelor or PhD is going to actually give me what is fulfilling to my life. It's not if with the right psychology.
Right.
Do you understand? The psychology has to be behind it for genuine, congruent reasons as to why you're doing it, not just for society, not just for your own pleasure, because that own pleasure should be more than that thing or that person or a situation or anything. It has to just be inside. Happiness is inside. You know, self-fulfillment is inside. All of that's inside, and it's alone. Not a partner, not even your children, not even your parents can give you that. That's a bonus. But you know, we put all of that hope, happiness, fulfillment on things around us. That's why society is breaking, because when things go wrong, then we go wrong. But when things go wrong and an individual can, you know, accept, grieve for a certain amount of time, as to I failed, or I've lost someone, or I've, you know, I'm separated or divorced, or I didn't achieve what I needed to achieve, and then pick themselves up very, very rapidly and do something even better and use that past as a learning. Now you cannot do that from a book theory. You cannot do that just from, you know, having knowledge on a surface. You got to be smarter and knowing that you've got meaning and purpose in life more so than what's your surroundings and your environment, or even people, or the economy, and use anything as an excuse.
Yeah.
And that's where even our faith and belief comes in. that's our power and our protection. And at the same time, it gives us that sort of like kickstart and jumpstart to sort of pick ourselves up, knowing that life is a struggle. That's where it all sort of like, you know, unravels and unfolds, that when you teach children how to live in this world, it's not just about the education, it's about knowing what to do with that education, what to do with that knowledge, how to cope with these situations. It's really, really about coping with challenges. We don't teach that. We want to avoid it, and we don't want to change, and we don't want to adapt. And change is what people hate the most.
Yep.
But it comes to you even more so in any situation, whether it's in relationships or in professionals or whatever it may be. You know, change is inevitable. And being uncomfortable. You need to be uncomfortable and take yourself out of those comfort zones, and that's what's going to make you learn. Do something you've never done before. Don't just do the one subject or the topic that you think you're good at. Do the complete opposite at one point, if you have the time and energy and space, or you're at that age in your life where you do something. Because, you know, you need to flip your mind.
Do something like you wouldn't do, you know, that wouldn't be ordinary part of your routine. Yeah. Challenge yourself.
You have to challenge yourself. And if the challenges really don't come to you, yes, you definitely got to challenge yourself. Bring it on yourself. Absolutely.
That's what people are scared of the most. It's the challenge and the fear of failure. I feel a lot of people that I come across, they're too scared to put themselves in the spotlight because they're fearful that they will do something wrong or they will be judged. And you just need to go for it. Put yourself forward.
Listening to your language just right now, it's so common that people always focus on what could go wrong than what could go right. Mm-hmm. And when you listen to a lot of personal development gurus and psychologists, and now there's a lot out there on the YouTube, on Facebook, you know, there's lots of just short videos on, you know, particular individuals that are very, very well known speaking, because now life is becoming so fast moving and forward, even with all the development and technology that's around, people are deteriorating in their mind. And they're not being able to cope, even with so much to make things easy for us, in technology-wise.
Yeah.
We ourselves as humans are failing. You know, we don't know how to cope with relationships. We don't have to cope with, you know, with any sort of like negative situation or challenges.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, and that's why all of this mindfulness and psychology and, you know, a lot of, you know, how to live and be and have a healthier, you know, sort of like well-being state of mind and body is vital.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of it comes out there, and you know, the focus is, you know, for every situation, how you look at it, and to take yourself out of those perspectives and to understand the way in which your brain works and thinks. And all of this is knowledge, learning, and again, personal development. There are personal development courses. I went to one, and it gave you so many different distinctions about life. And a lot of people said it was like a cult, or a lot of people benefited, and the others were like, well, I've taken bits from it. I mean, personally, I don't really get influenced by any one particular thing. I always absorb what I need to absorb, and I put it together. And I have a sort of like a variety of, you know, knowledge from coaching and positive psychology and mindfulness and, you know, whatever it may be, and NLP and the personal development course. And I'm constantly researching and reading about relationships and about, you know, just general psychology, just so that I could keep myself up to date, because it's continuously changing as well. And you need to move with the language. Your language is so important.
Mm-hmm.
By you saying something negative, the negative will even happen and occur.
SubhanAllah, that's so true.
You know, so, you know, things like that makes a big difference, and how you speak to each other and your children. So what your thoughts are so important, and that relays in your actions and in your voice and, you know, and your habits. All of these things are so vital. So you need to be aware that regardless of the conventional and, you know, the normal education that is given in school, that is just the tip of the iceberg as to what you need to learn. And as parents and as individuals of the community, we need to take it upon ourselves to either have workshops and, you know, bring societies and communities together with this type of learning about personal development, about how to cope with certain things, and, you know, raise topics and awareness, like how we're doing in the show, but on smaller scales in different areas, so people have access to it. And people can actually learn and have someone that they can turn to as a mentor, as a role model, and, you know, and learn to live life in a healthy way.
Okay, thank you so much, Fahima. Thank you for enlightening us on the subject. Inshallah, our viewers have also benefited from the discussion. Thank you so much. Unfortunately, we do need to come to a break. Inshallah, after the break, we'll be answering some of the viewers' questions. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to the second part of Making a House a Home, where we've been discussing personal development and encouraging continuous learning. Now, we're going to answer some of the questions, viewers, Fahima, if you could mm-hmm. answer them for me. We have a viewer who said, Zina, how do I help my two boys study? They are both in secondary school, but want to spend more time playing sports, and I know they need that, but I feel that they give very little to their academic studies.
Okay, parents need to take more control in managing mm-hmm. time and being balanced. And at the same time, you know, a lot of emphasis is placed upon what the child requires from their perspective. So you need to know that even though they have their own idea of time, you have to take back control. And say, you know, if you want to do sports, if you want to do certain things, you still got to do half an hour, 20 minutes of reading first.
Right.
Or you got to do, you know, whatever it is. It's got to be give and take. And it seems like I come across a lot of parents now that their children are taking over and taking control as to how the household runs. And the parents are letting it happen because they don't want to have the conflict.
Mm. Have the that conflict. Easy option out. Yeah.
Have that conflict, have that discussion. It won't mm-hmm. be a conflict. You need to take time, maybe a few days in a row or week after week, to discuss this, to get yourself to a place where you have taken back control and you are in control mm-hmm. because these are your children that you are responsible for.
Right.
As much as they want certain things, you are the parent with the extra knowledge and awareness, and they've got to understand that whatever you decide to do is for their benefit. That's one point that's very important, because a lot of parents are losing control, and because they feel they're not there enough, they're working, or there's not enough time, and they're not managing it properly. And this is, I'm talking about parents who both work, who do not have enough time, because it's about quality. It's about setting set rules, even if they're there with their grandparent or a babysitter, wherever it may be, whoever's, you know, looking after them. You've got to put things into place, mm-hmm. and you've got to set certain rules. And I watched a program even about the Chinese, you know, mum, and they're quite strict, and, you know, they're quite, you know, militant,
yeah.
And I do take some of that on board personally, but to be honest, there has to be balance. But you've got to encourage and push them and say that they can do more, because if you don't give them that drive for having, you know, to want more for themselves from a young age, they can easily slip. And yes, they get tired, yes, they get bored, but when you come after that day and you actually recollect what was actually happened for that day and how much they actually managed to do, they might complain and moan the first day, and the second day, third day, and then it will be okay. Mm. So, you know, when you become a coaching parent, you know how to, you know, address these sort of scenarios with regards to, you know, making even studying being exciting and fun, different ways of studying. There is studying which people just have this, you know, general concept of you just sitting in front of your desk or computer or reading a book. And it's mundane and it's boring. And a lot of the times, whatever you're studying and reading is not interesting. Mm. But it's okay. You need to do something that is not interesting. You need to do something you don't like. Now, we don't do that for our kids. We only want to please them and make sure they're happy. And they will get happiness. But they have to also do things and, you know, study certain things and take things on that is not part of their happiness that they would specifically choose. Just like when you go to GCSEs and you're studying for all these like 10, 12 subjects, you're telling me that everyone's gonna like each one of them? No, but every one of them has a part to play in your life in the future where you need that certain amount of knowledge to go forward.
Yeah.
You know, so you need to, you know, be able to explain things to them and make them understand about this life and this world and how it works. And then you're gonna be put in situations and scenarios that you're uncomfortable, you don't like. Yes, it takes your time. You could have been doing something better. But you know what? This is actually for your benefit too. Just like sometimes you need to take that medicine that tastes really horrible, but that's going to be, you know, going to be that cure for you.
Better for you, yeah. Yeah. Exactly. What about like something visual for them? Like I know my mum, when I was young, she would do a visual timetable of time for studying.
Yes, you can do that. A planner, of course.
Sometimes the visual, yes. Like you said before, the visual aids
absolutely
can help the child.
Oh, very much so.
Monitor it themselves, depending obviously on their age. They
Look,
can go
even
and tick
at a
it,
young age, actually,
it.
You're quite right. That's perfect because then you're organized. Then you know they're taking responsibility and they're following something that you've both set together and actually make it where you both set together and maybe give them a bit of leeway to say,
yes.
You know what, I'm going to do, you know, this first or that first, whichever, which they prefer.
But as long as they're following
exactly.
It will benefit both sides.
That's a very good idea, you know, to have a planner and have it big on there to be written so that you know that your child is getting a balanced lifestyle, you know, where they're going to have play, they're going to have sport, they're going to have activities, and they're going to have that, you know, that general learning. Studying is not easy. But you know what, when you try and also make your children study, not just when it's exam period, but every day.
Every day, yeah.
Every day, learn a fact. Every day, pick up the encyclopedia. Every day, learn a history point or whatever it may be. You know, you can come up with these creations that, you know, will get them to know things that when they build themselves up to a certain stage, it's not going to be so difficult for them, even as adults.
Exactly.
You need to do that.
It'll be a gradual process instead of just all together.
Yes, exactly. It takes away the tension, the stress. And it sets them into a really good habit and routine, knowing that this is what I got to do, whether I like it or not. But when I do this, I'm going to do something else. And plus, I'm just going to get it over and done with to begin with. Or sometimes I might find, you know what, I didn't even think I would enjoy that topic or that subject. But now I'm actually finding interest in it because you're opening up that world for them. And they are like sponges. And your influence is vital. And you have got influence if you take control.
Yeah.
Be that parent that is strong enough to be a leader in your household. Regardless of, you know, the time or anything, you know, show them that, you know, you love to learn and study and what it brings to you and give you. And you speak with passion. You speak with, you know, so much like, you know, like drive for, you know, learning and making them understand that your family is not about, oh, everyone's just going to do pharmacy or, you know, medicine or dentistry. No, no, no. It's about, you know, building yourself as a human into something that is to be proud of. Not just in the academic level, because you want to be able to have great conversations with people. So you want to tell them a fact that you learned about, you know, in the encyclopedia about, you know, an animal or, you know, a plant or an insect. You know, things like that. Make it something that they need to know, you know, to give them a sense of personality. Now that is building character. That is building a little human being who is going to be so amazing and bright in many areas. Not just what they like.
Inshallah. Thank you so much, Fahima, for that. Inshallah, hopefully that helps the viewer. I know it can be challenging for us, all parents. One
Definitely.
Of the most difficult things is homework. So inshallah, hopefully you're able to manage with that. The next viewer is Ali. And the question is, Islam is about increasing our knowledge. But what advice can be given to teach and encourage children about their religion as well as to practice it?
Again, it's about how you look at religion, because a lot of the times religion is negatively portrayed, that it's a must and it's a punishment if you don't. And, you know, a lot of the times it's something that people are doing without understanding the meaning for it.
Right.
You got to pray, you got to wear hijab. You got to read Quran, you got to learn the surah, because you need to be the one on top reciting it in the best way compared to all your friends. And that's as far as the parents go a lot of the time.
Which isn't enough, really.
Which
is
not even the actual, you know, essence of it all.
Yeah.
It's just touching the tip of the iceberg, okay? What goes underneath it is you telling them a story about that surah, or you telling them the reasons behind it and the protection it gives you and the blessings it gives you, and you sitting and reading even physiologically, when you're performing salah, it's a form of having a particular way of breathing when you say certain things, when you are bending and you're going down. You know, these are postures and prostrations that, you know, is actually good for your body, even in a scientific way, you know. So if you were to say, like, this is part of your exercise, this is part of your, you know, your protection, this is part of your spirituality, this is part of, you know, your benefit, this is part of, you know, your power to gain more, and show them examples when they do certain things, if they've read certain things and some things happen and your experience, share it. Islam is so much more than what is just being said that you've got to do that's halal and what you're not supposed to do, which is unlawful. It is so much more in between. Your treatment of people, your character, you know, and what that brings for you. And the stories are vast and varied when it comes to Islam. Don't just concentrate on, you know, the main points as well. Go deeper, make it more exciting, make them have the knowledge which is beyond, you know, whatever you would see normally. So that's what children want to hear. They love stories. They love to hear there's a moral behind it. In every story, there's a moral behind it. And with that, there's a lesson as to how to live life better and how to be a better person, how to treat people better, how to cope better, how to see things about life generally. There's always morals behind these stories of the prophets, of the imams, you know, of anything that you want to take upon.
Just like some children, they kind of, not idolize, but they really like superheroes. And they focus so much on superheroes, make certain characters their superheroes. Like there's this fantastic thing that I saw where a lady had created an Imam Hussein sip cup.
Yeah, I've seen that.
And I thought that is such a fantastic idea because it's constantly reminding them and they can see it's a figure of someone who was brave and who was, you know, was on a battlefield, and that they're constantly reminded of Imam Hussein alayhi salam and his thirst. And just having that object brings them towards religion. So making certain characters their role models, but also their superheroes in some, so that can draw them towards them.
That is an amazing point that you've made, because it just also made me think that, you know, we speak about the characters, but whoever's created this has made it like into this day and age where it brings that importance because it's into something like an object.
Yeah.
Because, you know, you see like a doll, or you might see like, you know, a poster up there, but we don't do that for the images that we normally have, but to have a reference to it in some form, in some way.
That's physical.
Then the child actually associates that with something important that they see elsewhere, and it's the same thing with our religion. So that is so good, and that's why we need to be creative and innovate these more of like these ideas for children with regards to Islam. And yes, there are plenty of books and there's translations, but in that form, that is just the start of what needs to actually happen.
Exactly,
because that is so vital in building and taking Islam into another level, which is in this day and age, modern, and what is used for other characters, why can't we do it for this?
Exactly.
And educate in that way. And they're going to wonder, even the younger ones, is who is that person, who is that character? Just like they like a doll or a character from a different superhero or a movie, you know, they're looking at that in that particular way.
Exactly. And I think it's just a fantastic
idea. It's an amazing
idea. Constantly bringing them towards that character. Enlightening the love.
And you're educating them and you're giving them knowledge about what it represents, what
it teaches.
Give them
a hadith, give them something. And so they're physically doing something as well as learning. And a lot of children, they learn through
touching.
Touching.
Yes,
and meaning, in the world we live in now, unfortunately, it's very materialistic.
Yes, and visual.
So, and it's, you need to have something to touch to in order to learn or to find it important. So, you know, that's
it's a fantastic idea. Absolutely. And learning is also for children with regards to Islam. It's more about also, you know, building that belief which is non-visible. You know, it's having that some sort of spirituality you can't see. You can't, you know, you can feel it. Each individual feels it differently. So how do you relay that to your children? You need to also, a lot of adults probably don't do this because they themselves feel they have that lack of knowledge. But a very simple, you know, essence or a very simple, you know, technical point that you feel that you can create and make that something big. And then from there, it will grow. And it's also an opportunity to remind yourself and educate yourself again.
Yeah. It's very true. Yeah, thank you so much for that. Now we'll go on to the next view. It's Huda. And the question is, I have a disabled child and she is the last of three who are all normal, but she was diagnosed with Down syndrome very late in my pregnancy. But I knew I would still keep her because this is a gift. However, I do find that the rest of the community feel uncomfortable in her presence and look at me with pity. I want to educate and make them realize that we are quite a normal family still, even with the challenges, but more awareness needs to be out there about dealing with disability. Now, my daughter is quite young and doesn't realize the stairs, but as she gets older, I do not want her to be affected by the difference of treatment towards her.
That is a very powerful statement and question. Because as much as we talk about everyday children, you know, trying to discover how to study and learn, we do disregard people that are struggling with disability, for example, or any sort of like, you know, lapse in their, you know, physical being or ability mentally as well. And the awareness again is also about the psychology of how people around us need to sort of like come, not with pity as she wants understanding. You know, mm-hmm. it's about also involving her to the normal, because I have come across women that have children with disability and they created their own WhatsApp group because they felt that, you know, if they went into a normal sort of setting, their child would either be left at home or would not be spoken about, or even the siblings wouldn't understand that there's a difference yeah. until later on, because they don't know how to relay that information to them. And you know, subhanAllah, it's very brave of her to be talking and speaking out there, because more of this needs to be out there, and we need to be more inviting. We need to be a little bit more knowing that differences exist, even if it's not disability. We all are different. Mm-hmm. So with a child of her age, you know, being so young and not knowing the stairs, to begin with, it's just good to educate her that we are all different. We are all special in our own way. Allah has created us and it's individual, it's a gift. And we've got to accept what we do, and it's, yes, it's difficult. And there's always, you know, stigma attached disability or people that's going to pick on you, but then you're going to find that, but then you overcome that, because within your community, within your unit, your family unit, you build it like as if it isn't that much. And you yourself have to put yourself out there. Don't, you know, put yourself in a shell yeah. as well. You need to go out there and speak about this. You need to create awareness, because, you know, it can happen to anyone, not just even from birth. It can happen in an accident, or it can happen in any form, in any way. Yeah. It can touch any one of us at any time. So we should always, you know, feel that need to learn more about other people's situations and accept it. And if we can't accept it, also understand it, so that we can bring that acceptance to our homes. Mm. Don't just stare. Don't just comment. Don't just, like, you know, disregard them to be in your circle or in your space because of that as well. Mm. And people that are dealing with this, they need to be outspoken themselves, that we are a normal family, you know, and these are the challenges and the difficulties. And we need normal people to help us, and we need people of the same kind to also be part of this group. Mm. So things like that can be. And like I said, just a WhatsApp group is enough to start building it bigger and bring it into the community. You know, have a space where you can actually speak about this in the mosque one day. And, you know, have children that are, you know, disabled and not play together, because normally we also push them in these little, you know, different, you know, groups, places and yeah. groups, which is not necessary. It's okay for the learning ability wise, but to play generally, it should be open and free.
Should be open, yeah. Very true, yeah.
So, you know, we always tend to push them in these places, and it actually creates
groups.
The separations.
Yeah.
We create that. So we need to, alongside with the, you know, the need for having a separate way of learning and, you know, living, but integrate as much as you can.
And would you say another thing would be good is, if you do see a child with a disability, instead of staring at them, go up. What's wrong? Or, because I know some people that I'm aware of, they prefer to be asked what is wrong and to be told that, oh, I have this disability, instead of someone just staring at them.
Yeah.
Because they feel like they are more valued if someone comes up to them and says, oh, what's wrong? Why?
Just
why?
Be careful of the language, because
yes.
the wrong may be. Not be something
not wrong,
that,
but like, yeah. oh, you have to find a certain way, but
yes.
it's better than staring.
Well, just, you know, just build a conversation generally,
yeah.
just to, you want to get to know them.
Exactly, yeah.
And that will
befriend
come up.
Them,
befriend
and then,
them.
And they will
yes.
open up.
They will open up, because most of the time people just, you know, walk past them.
Yeah.
So even if it's not even directed at the child, but you just, in, you know, interacting with the parent and then even looking at the child and interacting, say, hi, how are you? What are you doing today? What's your, you know, what was your time like? You know, what was your special day today? What was your activity today? You know, and then invite your child to sit and play in a
yeah.
different way. And it's good learning for your child to know that there's other people like that. And they need to also be grateful of their situation and appreciate other people's situations and what they're in.
Yeah.
And, you know, that's another learning opportunity for, you know, both families to mix and mingle and get together. And, you know, it creates great space for, you know, continuous, you know, development for, you know, how we can live together regardless of any situation.
And understanding your differences and living with differences. I think when you're more physically involved and like you're saying, socializing with people.
Yeah.
You understand on another level that
Definitely.
What they're going through, and so you can not, obviously they don't want to have sympathy because they are just normal human beings,
yeah.
but you can empathize with them when they are in certain situations,
yeah,
where they can feel a bit discriminated against. So yeah, like you said, we do need to be very
definitely careful. We need to be careful of our wording. Yeah, absolutely.
Definitely. But inshallah, we have to go to a come to an end. Sorry, we've finished. We can keep on talking about this subject.
Yes, we could, definitely.
So yes, thank you so much, Fahima, for
that. You're
welcome. It was another great insight on the topic, and I hope the dear viewers have benefited from the discussion, and inshallah you all have. But inshallah we'll see you again on another episode of Making a House a Home. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.